Well, good morning, everybody, and welcome to day 105. I hope you're doing well. I hope you had a good weekend, despite the weather. I have to admit that we had a bit of a washout this weekend, to be quite honest. We'd planned to go for a bike ride on Saturday, and I'd been kind of really looking forward to it, and been planning for it for a little while, getting everything ready to go for a bike ride, and saw the weather on Saturday morning, and I was like, yeah, we can still do it. We can still get out for a bike ride. So I spent ages getting everything ready, got the bikes on the bike rack, got Flora's little trailer in the boot with the wheels off, and it took me ages to get stuff ready. Morning, Melissa. And then we drove out to this place where we're going to go riding, Gibson Forest, if you've ever been there, which is a great place for mountain biking. I'd never been there before, but I'd done lots of mountain biking before, so I thought it'd be good. And then when we got there, we realised that not only was it raining much, much more heavily in the middle of Poland than it was in Lancaster, but also that the trails in which I thought were there, that I thought there was like a green trail for like families, but it turns out there wasn't. There was only like a red trail for like mountain bikers. And then I was thinking, with Flora's little trailer on the back, we probably can't drag her around in it. So basically we drove, well, I spent ages getting all the bikes ready. We put it in the back of the car, and then we drove out into the middle of Boland, which took about an hour, sat in the car, had a picnic in the rain in the car, and then drove home again. And that was basically our Saturday. It was a great day, slightly disappointing. And I just thought this morning, you know, thinking about that headline as well, you might have seen Donald Trump can't use, or the Rolling Stones have said to Donald Trump they can't use his songs, and I thought it was a clever use of the headline. You can't always get what you want, Donald Trump. And in life, you can't always get what you want. But I wonder this morning, as we come to think about that idea, how you handle it, because it's just a reality of life that you'll come up against obstacles in your life that you find that are difficult to get over. And when things are taken away from you that you want, it can be quite a difficult thing to handle. Melissa says car picnics are the best. Yeah, it was a good kind of redemption of what was a terrible morning. So, but yeah, man, this coffee's strong. Yeah, so you can't always get what you want, but how do you kind of handle that when you end up in those situations? Because it can be very difficult in lots of ways, in ways more serious than just like, you know, a Saturday morning gone wrong. For lots of us, I think we have things in our life that we really hold on to. And when they're taken away from us, we really struggle. So things like just ideas and concepts that we attach ourselves to and find meaning and identity in, like success or comfort or family or health. And these things are all kind of good things that are gifts given to us from God. But we can get to this kind of point where we elevate them to a state where they don't just become good gifts to us from God, but they become gods to us that we live our lives for. And when they're taken away from us, it feels like everything collapses, and we put all of our trust and all of our hope and all of our confidence in our career or in that next holiday or in our family relationships. And of course, you cannot go through life without some of that stuff at some point being broken down. And the question is, can you find the resilience to be able to overcome it or not? And I think that's the kind of place that we find David in this morning in Psalm 16. He's in this place where it feels like actually what he is coming up against is the ultimate test of things being taken away from us. It feels like he's actually coming up against the threat of death itself, which is where all of this really starts to crunch. Where do you put your security? Where do you put your identity in life? Where do you put your ambitions in life when you get a terminal illness? When someone close to you passes away, when tragedy hits, then all of a sudden the career that you longed for and worked so hard for, the relevance of it disappears. The holiday that you worked for so long for, the relevance of it disappears. The comfort that you so enjoy and that food that you surround yourself with and the relationships in your life that have given you meaning for so long suddenly seem less relevant when you're in a situation like David is here, where he's crying out for his very life. And of course, we know we will all be in this situation one day. So let's listen to his words, let's listen to his prayer this morning and see what he says. And this is how he starts his crying out. Preserve me, O God, for in you I take refuge. I say to the Lord, you are my Lord. I have no good apart from you. As for the saints in the land, they are the excellent ones in whom is all my delight. The sorrows of those who run after another god shall multiply. Their drink offerings of blood I will not pour out or take their names on my lips. The Lord is my chosen portion and my cup. You hold my lot. The lines have fallen in pleasant places. Indeed, I have a beautiful inheritance. I bless the Lord who gives me counsel. In the night also instructs me. I have set the Lord before me. Because he is at my right hand, I will not be shaken. Therefore, my heart is glad and my whole being rejoices. My flesh also dwells secure, for you will not abandon me to Sheol, or let your Holy One see corruption. You make known to me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy, and at your right hand are pleasures forevermore. Man, what a beautiful psalm this is. But it does start with that crying out from David there. Preserve me, O Lord. You know, he's crying out for his very life. And he says that the people around him, they are running to other gods. And he says, the sorrow of those that run to other gods shall multiply. And David says, I will have absolutely nothing to do with where they are worshipping. Their drink offerings of blood I will not pour out or take their names on my lips. And guys, as you face the pressures and the stresses of life, even this morning, you will be tempted to run to the places where other people in culture run to when times of difficulty hit. Whether that be comfort eating, whether that be alcohol, whether that be turning back and finding your identity and security in your career, in your family relationships, in things that bring you comfort. But David says here, the people that run to those idols, those gods in times of desperations, that actually their sorrow will multiply as they turn to those things, because they won't provide them with security. They won't provide them with the comfort that they think it's gonna, that they promise, and it's just gonna end up feeling empty, you know, like tasting ash. Instead, David says, verse 2, I say to the Lord, and the capital's there, for Yahweh, you are my Lord, lowercase for Adonai. I say to Yahweh, you are my Adonai. What he's meaning by that is, I say to the God of the universe, the God that flung stars into space, the God that created me, the God that understands me, the God that knows me intimately in every single part of my being. I say to that God that he is the one who will be Lord of my life, not comfort, not success, not family, not ambition, not that next holiday, not that next paycheck. I will put my security in knowing that the God of the universe is the Lord of my life. That's what David turns to in this moment of desperation. Oh, preserve me, O God, for in you I take refuge. The Lord, Yahweh, who is my Lord. And it's so different from those around him that are putting their trust in other things. And then he tells us why. He says, the Lord is my chosen portion and my cup. You hold my lot. I'm putting everything in. I'm putting everything in with this Lord who saved me. The lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. Indeed, I have a beautiful inheritance. And I guess, you know, we don't know exactly what David means there in verse 6. The lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. But we assume that he's probably talking about the promised land. That he has this beautiful inheritance that the Lord has given him, living in God's place. And now, of course, we know that the promised land is symbolic. As the, I guess the thing about the promised land is the temple, and the temple is the dwelling place of God. That's the whole reason why we're thinking on Sunday about how the Israelites were brought out of Egypt through the Red Sea. And the reason that God brought them out was just not just to free them, but also so that he could meet with them and be with them in the promised land. And that's the kind of inheritance that David talks about here. You know, the lions have fallen for me in pleasant places. He's given them this huge area of land, this massive inheritance of fertile land, of milk and honey, and it's wonderful and it's amazing. But what's most amazing about it is the fact that God is there. And you think this is true for you this morning? You know, as you stand here in Christ watching this video this morning, in the midst of whatever is happening in your life right now, the lions have fallen for you in pleasant places. He has a beautiful inheritance for you. And all these other things around us that are promising satisfaction to us, promising escape from the trials of life, promising to bring us some kind of freedom, they are nothing in comparison to the scale and to the extent of the promised land of God's presence in your life. Not a physical reality, but a spiritual reality that encompasses everything. You know, you think everything that you can see with your eyes is owned by Jesus. You know, I think it's Abraham Kuyper, I can never say his name. He says, there is not one square inch of creation over which Jesus does not cry, mine. He's Lord of everything. And yet, as you come into relationship with him this morning, it becomes yours as well. You know, this whole planet is ours, and it will be ours from this moment and into eternity. He's given you a beautiful inheritance and a future where you'll be free from the sufferings of this world, and you'll live in that land forevermore in all its perfection. And all sin will cease, all suffering will cease, all the tears will be wiped away, and we'll live in that place forever. So in times of suffering and trials, when you're crying out, don't be tempted to turn to think of worldly ideas of comfort and success and relationships to bring you satisfaction. Instead, make Yahweh your Adonai. Make the Lord of your life, who brings you this beautiful inheritance. He's made the lines fall for you in pleasant places. And then we'll skip down a few verses to the end there, verses 9 to 11. David then says, therefore, because of all of these things, because I can put my trust and dependence in this God who's called me into a beautiful inheritance, who's made the lines fall for me in pleasant places, who's given me this promise of a future secure in him, and is so different from the other idols that I can turn to in my life that bring no satisfaction, because he's rescued me, therefore, my heart is glad, my whole being rejoices, and my flesh also dwells secure, for you will not abandon me to Sheol or let your Holy One see corruption. Now, these are words that Peter quotes in Acts chapter 2 when he's preaching the resurrection to people. Because I guess in life, the trouble is when we put our trust and our dependence upon worldly ideas of comfort or relationships or beauty or power or success, whatever it is, whether you're trusting in your career, whether you're trusting in a certain relationship, whether you're trusting in your reputation amongst friends and the way people see you, is that all of that stuff can fall away in an instant when you face the hardest things in life, like David's saying, I've never said that already. But when you are diagnosed with a terminal illness, when somebody close to you dies, when it feels like the whole world is crashing down, you can't depend on those things. But you can depend on the resurrection promise of Jesus. I know that for sure, that when everything else is falling around and you cry out to God, preserve me, O Lord, in you I take refuge, that you can stand firm in these promises of saying, therefore my heart is glad in the midst of this incredible trial in my life. Therefore my heart is glad, my whole being rejoices, my flesh dwells secure, because God will not abandon you to the pits of hell, because he's rescued you, because he's promised you an inheritance, and because he's going to lead you into it in the future. So I just really want to you guys to understand this morning, as you go out into this day, you know, everywhere in the world, we're surrounded by messages that tell us that, you know, we should put our trust and confidence in this thing, we should put our trust and confidence in this thing, you know, you need this next job, you need this next holiday, you need people to like you, you need people to respect you. All of those are good things. I'm not saying they're not, but none of them will ever bring you this kind of assurance and resilience that means no matter what happens in life, you can stand up secure and cry out to God, save me, knowing that he's going to listen to you. You make known to me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore. Just amazing, isn't it, to think that one day we'll be with him in eternity future, where all tears will be wiped away, where, you know, C.S. Lewis, and he sort of describes it at the end of the Narnia stories, it's like somehow even the grass was greener. That in that future that awaits us, it's just like, oh, it's just indescribably good. Like everything you've ever longed for is fulfilled in you, and the world is, as it's almost like it's gone from black and white to technicolor, you know. And we stand on that promise this morning and look forward to it. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore. And that's where you and I will live into eternity future. So, yeah, Celia says, love it. We can stand on the words of our God, the one true God. We can. You can, yeah. So whatever you... Look, guys, this next week, I don't know what's going to happen today. You might be full of disappointments. this week might be full of disappointments, but just please don't be tempted to turn to those things that, as David says, you know, the sorrows of those that run after another God shall multiply. So stay away from that stuff. Don't put your trust and dependence upon it. Put your trust and dependence upon Jesus Christ and this beautiful inheritance. At his right hand are pleasures forevermore. So let's do it. Let me pray for us as we finish here. Father, I thank you so much that you have led us into this land where the boundaries are falling in pleasant places, where there is a beautiful inheritance that awaits us. And Father, I just pray for us today by the power of your Holy Spirit. Would you come to rest on each and every one of us, Father, and just reassure us of that fact that you have called us into this inheritance by the power, by the resurrection power of Jesus. And that, Father, we long for that day where we will sit with you and know that at your right hand are pleasures forevermore. But Father, through these current trials and tribulations that we live in now, we cry out to you, Lord, would you preserve us? Would you keep us? Would you fix our eyes on Jesus and help us to live for the life to come, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen, guys. Well, thanks for those of you that have been with me this morning. Great to just be with you, getting into God's word. Have an awesome day. And just, yeah, keep your eyes fixed upon Jesus, especially when stuff goes wrong today. You can't always get what you want, or can you? Because actually, in Christ, the reality is, you can. And in him are pleasures forevermore. And that's really what I want to say to you this morning. Things might go wrong, but actually, in the fullness of time, they've been worked out for his glory and for our good. So guys, keep going, have an awesome day, and I will see you soon.